Unity's prefab system allows us to take game objects from the scene and save them into the project folder, preserving the settings and components in the process. Today, we'll break down Unity's prefab system and learn all about the benefits that prefabs offer, and we'll do so by creating custom LEGO designs in Unity's LEGO Micro Game. Welcome to, or welcome back to, iHeart Game Dev, my channel all about game development. A quick shout out to Unity for sponsoring this video and series, and now, let's get started. A prefab allows us to create reusable assets out of game objects we have in the scene. Prefabs store all of the game object's components, property values, and even its child game objects. Child meaning any game object found underneath the dropdown of a selected game object. To create a prefab, all we need to do is drag the game object from the hierarchy into the project folder. And if it isn't a prefab already, Unity will automatically convert it into one. This can be noted by the blue cube icon next to the game object's name in the hierarchy. When our new prefab is selected, we can see in the inspector that all the components and properties have been saved. And at the top, it'll now say prefab asset. Alternatively, we can create a prefab in the project window by just right-clicking, going to create, and selecting prefab. This will create an empty prefab with just a transform component. And before we move on, it's worth noting that Unity's icons have changed before, so keep that in mind depending on the version of Unity that you are using. This version is 2020.3. So what exactly does a prefab do? Why should we make them? In many and most games, we'll often see characters and pieces of scenery reused over and over again. These game objects share the same logic, the same materials, same components, and by design are actually intended to do so. This repetition allows players to learn how to properly handle different enemies and navigate the environment, which results in a feeling of satisfaction and mastery as players grow to understand how the game's mechanics work. And as developers, reusing assets is imperative. It saves us time, helps us implement consistent game design, and, for prefabs in Unity, keeps us organized during a game's development. Let's take this to a conceptual level. Imagine a game object selected in the hierarchy as a box. Inside of our box, we have components such as transform, rigidbody, scripts, etc., all of which have their own properties and property values. Additionally, this game object box can have child game object boxes within it. And those boxes can have their own components, properties, and children, and so on. All of these combine to make our game object function as it's expected to. Now let's say that we want to make an enemy game object. It has a transform component and a few scripts that allow it to look at and move towards a target and can fire projectiles in the same direction that it's moving. Now at this point, our enemy game object refers to a single enemy inside of our game. But what if we wanted to make more enemies in our scene? We could just duplicate our enemy game object and place each throughout the map. And that looks good. But wait. What if we want to change the movement speed of our enemies to give our player more of a challenge? Now, because each duplicated enemy is its own game object, noted by the transparent cube icon, to change the movement speed of all of the enemies, we would need to modify this movement speed value on every single enemy game object. And this leads us to one of the primary benefits of prefabs. If we imagine the box again, but now apply it to our current scene with all of the individual enemies, there's no direct connection to each duplicate enemy. This means that they can all have their own components, property values, and child game objects without impacting one another. Do we really want the exact same looking character to have different functionality? Wouldn't that confuse players in a bad way? But if we rewind back to the point where we only had our original enemy game object, and we pulled it into the project window to create a prefab instead, we'll notice that if we now duplicate the enemy, each new duplicate also has the prefab icon. This is because each game object in the hierarchy with the prefab icon is what's known as an instance of the original prefab that is now saved in the project window. Again, imagine our three enemy boxes, but now each is a prefab instance. The difference with instances is that they are all interconnected and point back to the original prefab in the project window. What this means is that any change that we apply to the root or base enemy prefab in the project window will be applied to all of the prefab instances. Likewise, if there is any change to the properties, components, or children of a prefab instance, we have the option to apply it back to the root, and therefore the change will apply to all instances once again. But in both cases, if that same property has already been modified on a different given prefab instance, that value won't be updated. This is faster and more reliable for us as game developers. Knowing that our changes won't skip any game objects outside of the instances that we've already purposefully modified ourselves. Now, modifications to a prefab instance are actually known as overrides. We can see overrides in the top right of the inspector when an instance is selected. In this case, we'll modify the enemy's distance parameter, and when the override menu is opened and selected, the editor shows a comparison between the original prefab value and the change specific to this instance. It's also highlighted in bold and has a blue marker on the left-hand side of the inspector. And if we add a component, then every property of the component is highlighted in blue. To apply overrides back to the base prefab, we have the option to apply all overrides at the bottom of the initial dropdown, or we can apply specific overrides by selecting it from the dropdown list and finding the apply menu. We also have the option to revert all or specific overrides. And if we do not apply the override, then this instance will be the only game object with that modification. If we want to edit a prefab directly, we also have access to prefab mode. We can get to this by double-clicking on a prefab. Prefab mode allows us to more easily focus on and openly modify a prefab, removing child components, modifying properties, and adding or removing components without worrying about overrides. Alternatively, we can open the prefab in context prefab mode with the arrow next to the prefab instance. This mode has options to show the other game objects in the current scene. When finished with our changes, we can then save or turn on autosave and press on the arrow on the left-hand side of the hierarchy to go back to the main editor. We will often be asked to open prefab mode if we try to make edits to a prefab instance, like removing a child component. And it is worth mentioning that specific to the transform component and overrides, the root prefab in the project window's transform will only set the initial origin of an instance. Once in the scene, the transform of each instance is disregarded and won't show up as an override. Unity's docs state that this is intentional, simply because there are very few instances where two game objects are supposed to share the same transform value. In our case, it wouldn't make sense to have two enemies sharing the same transform. Okay, so we have a solid understanding of the base purpose of prefabs, where we can create infinite instances of the same game object and apply overrides to the base prefab asset and know it will impact nearly every instance. What else can we do with prefabs? Let's say that the player of our game has made it to the next level, and we want to continue using our original enemy, but we also want to spice things up. We want some of our enemies to be a different color and fire and move at twice the speed. Once again, we can make these modifications to a handful of instances with overrides. But doesn't this seem familiar? Like when we originally duplicated our enemy before using the prefab system. Doing this one at a time is tedious and can lead to unexpected errors if we accidentally mess up. Instead, we have a feature of Unity's prefab system called prefab variants. What's awesome about prefab variants is that we are essentially making a duplicate of the original prefab asset and applying the override to the specific properties. But for the rest of the unchanged components, properties, and children, they retain the reference to the original prefab. So what this means is that if we make a prefab variant of the enemy and call it Super Enemy, we can modify the brick colors, movement speed, and fire rate, and these changes will only impact this new variant. And if we then apply changes to the original, we'll also see it reflected in the variant as long as it wasn't the brick colors, movement speed, or fire rate, because that's what we changed exclusively to create this variant. As mentioned, prefabs can have children, and what's awesome is that these child game objects can also be prefabs themselves. Let's say that we create a new prefab from the project window titled Enemy Fleet, and we want three enemies in each fleet. We want our super enemy prefab variant at the front, and two original enemy prefabs behind. Because these game objects are prefab instances, if we modify and apply overrides, they will be reflected in each. And what's cool is that overrides to child prefabs can actually be applied on the parent prefab instead. So these changes only appear on instances of the parent prefab. Now, what if we want our player to fight multiple waves of enemy fleets? We could just place a bunch around the map, but we'd be forgetting an awesome feature of prefabs. We can instantiate prefabs at runtime through scripts. In this example code, we have the instantiate function that will create a new instance of the enemy fleet every 5 seconds. And the instantiate function can be used to create any new prefab passed in as a reference, so the possibilities are quite endless. The last subject of prefabs is what's known as unpacking. Unpacking is the complete opposite of creating a prefab. By right-clicking on a prefab instance, navigating to prefab, and selecting unpack, we will see that the blue prefab icon becomes the standard game object icon. And if we choose unpack completely, the children of the selected prefab instance will also be converted back to a standard game object. And that is actually how these ships were made to begin with, using the LEGO Microgames prefabs. Unpacking each prefab, combining them, making sure that the center is at the origin, renaming the game object, and then pulling the final ship creation down from the hierarchy to the project menu. We can create brand new prefabs for our mods. Awesome! In the next and final episode of this series, we'll walk through the process of creating our very own mod in the LEGO Microgame, and we'll detail how we can build, publish, and share our games with the community. If you want to join an awesome growing community, we would love to have you in the iHeartGameDev channel Discord. And for updates on the next video, feel free to follow me on Twitter. But that is all for today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.